الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم ومن يوت الحكمة فقد أوتي خيرا كثيرا صلوات We have just concluded the 23rd eve of Ramadan, Laylatul Qadr. And after that, you know, people just wait for Eid. That's the next thing in the mind. And as I had mentioned in the majalis from the eve of 19th till the 21st of Ramadan, that the theme that I was talking about was this extraordinary fadilat of the virtue and quality of Ali as far as God-gifted knowledge is concerned. And my focus was more on Nahjul Balaghah. And the plan, inshallah, I have two, three nights more. Then we go into the Quran competition and award nights, and then it's Eve of Eid. I would take this opportunity basically to talk about two or three themes from Nahjul Balaghah just to create that interest. Inshallah, you will then be able to look into it more even after the month of Ramadan. For tonight, I have a sermon from Nahjul Balaghah, which is sermon number 209. And this is a very interesting conversation, and the theme of that basically is about the issue of our relationship to this dunya. You know, what is a Muslim supposed to do? Are we expected to shun the dunya and the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us? Or is a Muslim alive to submerge himself into the luxuries of this dunya? Or is there a middle way of looking at the relationship between us and dunya and the mali dunya? And this is a very interesting conversation of Amir al-Mu'mineen, which is not really a khutbah as such. And the background is that Amir al-Mu'mineen had a companion who was an army officer in the previous administrations also, a companion of Ali, and one day he became ill. And Amir al-Mu'mineen decided to go and visit him, what we call ayadat, ayadate, mariz. And this is a very recommended deed in Islam. There is a very famous hadith, udul mariz, that when those whom that you know are not feeling well, it is recommended to go and visit them. So visiting a sick itself is a highly recommended deed in Islam. And we see, for example, it's not even that, you know, the younger one who to go and do the iyadat or the older one, it can even be other way around. You remember the story when Imam Hassan and Hussein, very young, became ill once, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to went for their ayadah to visit them. And so this is the grandfather going for visiting the grandchildren. And so when we look at this, this is where it was very normal that Amir al-Mu'mineen would go and visit one of his companions. Now, when we look at the story, the way it has come in sermon number 209 of Nahjul Balaghah, the name of the companion given in Nahjul Balaghah is Al-Ala bin Ziyad. But when you compare other sources of the same story, for example, Usul Kafi, you'll see there the name is different. It's not Al-Ala bin Ziyad, it's Al-Rabi' bin Ziyad. And keeping in mind the difference between Nahjul Balaghah and Usul Kafi, maybe this is the time I can ask you the question, if you're listening carefully to my majalis on that issue. Is Nahjul Balaghah a book of hadith? It is a book of Arabic literature. It's a book of adab. And when you compare that with Usul Kafi, that's a book of hadith. So whenever you see a slight difference there, you know, this is where we would see that from the technical point of view, you would give preference to Usul-e-Kafi over Nahjul Balaghah. And interestingly, Sayyid Razi, looking at this statement of Amir al-Mu'mineen in this conversation that he has in that visit, he's looking at from adab point of view, from the eloquence and the beauty of the words, whereas Sheikh Kulaini is looking at it from the hadith point of view. And so Nahjul Balaghah for this story doesn't have sanad, no narration chain of narrators there. But the same story in Usul-e-Kafi has the sanad and the chain of narrators. So this is one point that I had mentioned in the previous talks, that there is a difference between Nahjul Balaghah and Usul-e-Kafi in that way. And so the preferred opinion would be that it was Ar-Rabi' ibn Ziyad, who was a known companion of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. So Imam went, of course, when Imam goes for iyadat of somebody, he doesn't go alone, you know, he has his companions, his friends, entourage with him. And so he sat down, talked with Rabi' ibn Ziyad. There's nothing to do with Ibn Ziyad. You know, it's just common names in Arabic. And after asking, you know, about his health, Imam happened to notice that the house of Rabi ibn Ziyad was a vast, big house. Now, it was not out of ordinary for an army officer, you know, to have that kind of a huge house. But this is where Amir al-Mu'mineen, you know, doesn't end his conversation with the issue of just ayadat. He looked at the house of Rabi ibn Ziyad, and then he looked at the, you know, that is normally, it's bigger than the normal sizes of the house. So he asked him, ما كنت تصنع بسعة هذه الدار في الدنيا أنت إليها في الآخرة كنت أحوج. O Rabi ibn Ziyad, what will you do with such a big house in this dunya while you need such a big house in the akhirah? So this is how he is starting the conversation. And this is where, you know, an advisor who knows balaghat and fasahat, this is how he would put the thing so that, you know, the audience starts thinking about it. And this is where the question comes up that, you know, is Amir al-Mu'mineen against having a big house? No. There is nothing wrong in having a big house as long as it is your you know, legitimately earned income, that's fine. Actually, there are hadiths from the Prophet and the Imams where we are told that one of the fortunes of a mu'min is to have a big house, spacious house. You know, so there's nothing wrong in, you know, it doesn't mean a mu'min means somebody, you know, who should just live in a hut. No. No, this is a hadith of the Prophet where he says, Man sa'ad min sa'adatil mar'a al-muslim al-maskan al-wasi'. One of the fortunes of a mu'min, a Muslim, is that he would have a vast or big house. And so it's not that Amir al-Mu'mineen is against big house. Actually, there is one narration with one of the imams where a person had a small house. It was not even enough for him. And imam actually helped him. Said, why don't you go and get another house, a bigger one? And this fellow says, that bus, you know, there are sentimental memories attached with this house. This is my father's house. So Imam used the term, he says, you know, I don't want to translate it literally. Basically, he says, you know, let us put it this way, that if your father was ignorant, would you want to be ignorant? Yes, memories are memories, but, you know, if there is a need now, you need a bigger house, you move on to a bigger house. And so we see even in the seerah of the Ahlul Bayt that to have a big house is not an issue. But then this is where it comes to the issue of connection of this dunya with akhirah. And so Ali is not against having a big house. He says to Rabi bin Ziyad, he says, make this house, a big house, as a means in order to gain success in the hereafter. And he says to him, وَبَلَىٰ إِن شِئْتَ بَلَغْتَ بِهِ الْآخِرَةِ. Yes, if you wish, you can take this house with its vastness to the in the hereafter. And you can do that. And how do you do that? This is where you see the issue of, you know, the connection which is between what is known as the right, you know, the way of how you use the dunya for your success in the akhirah. Salawat manik bara. Amir al-Mu'minin explains three ways to him. You can do three things, and you will be able to take this house with you to the, of course, in a better quality, inshallah, in the akhirah. And he says, number one, taqri fiha zayf, host guests and mehman in their house. If you have guests coming in and you serve them and entertain them, you know, this is one way that you will be able to maintain this house in the akhirah. We know the example of Anbiya, people like Ibrahim alayhi salam, even when he lived in the desert in a tent, he would still wait for a traveler to pass by and stop him and say, you know, come and have a meal with us. When you look at Imam Hassan bin Hassan al-Mushtaba alayhi salatu wasalam, we see, you know, similar examples of, you know, hosting those who are mehman and especially the travelers. Number two, watasilu fi harrahim. The second method where you will be able to take your house from this dunya to the akhirah is to help your relatives to maintain silatul rahim. And this is where, you know, letting them coming in, meeting them, and helping them from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to you. And, you know, Quran has strongly emphasized the issue of silatul rahim, to maintain the ties and the relationship. To the extent that there are more ayat about it, and more ayat condemning cutting their relationship than the ayat about namaz. Amir al-Mu'minin has a statement where he says, sometimes you will see evil people, they are being blessed with abundance by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as far as dunya is concerned. And he says, if you see, you will see that maybe one of the reasons is that they are good to their relatives. They help them when they are in need. Whereas you would have a mu'min who is in restrained condition. Is a mu'min, but really doesn't care about the relatives. So silatul rahim is the second point that Imam has. If you do silatul rahim, this house with his bigness can be yours in the akhirah. And number three, وَيْتُطْلِعُ بِنَهَا الْحُقُوقُ مَطَالِعَهَا. Make sure that when the time comes to pay the dues which are wajib on you from the religious point of view, you fulfill them and pay them. If you do these three things, hosting the guest, helping the relative, paying the huquq and the wajibat, monetary issues here, فَإِذًا عَنْتَ قَدْ بَلَغْتَ بِهَا الْآخِرَةِ. Then indeed you would have taken this house with you in the akhirah. Salawat alaykum wa rahmatullah. So after hearing, you know, I'm sure Rabi bin Ziyad, initially when Imam asked him, you know, what are you going to do with such a big house? You need this in the akhirah. Momentarily, you know, Rabi, like any other human being, would have been kind of, you know, taken back. What is Imam going to say? And then Imam explained to him that I'm not saying that you know, it's wrong to have such a house, but you can do this, things where you will get this in the akhirah. Then Rabi bin Ziyad complained to the Imam about his brother. He had a brother by the name of Asim, Al-Asim bin Ziyad. And Imam says, what is the complaint that you have about him? He says, Labis al-aba wa takhalla min ad-dunya. Unlike me, that I have a good house, I have a good, you know, lifestyle, my brother has put on the aba, and he has abandoned the dunya. Now, these are two words describing his lifestyle. Basically, he has become like the Sufis, you know, avoiding the luxuries of this dunya, using not, you know, good quality of clothes, and detaching himself from the wealth and from the family, also ignoring the duties that he has towards himself as well as his wife and children. And they are put into distress. And when Imam heard that, basically Imam said, bring him here. So he wasn't there, he was called and he came. And Imam looked at him. And right in the beginning, Imam says, Ya Udayya Nafsa, O the enemy of yourself. You think you are doing something good? Don't you realize that the shaitan has overcome you? By shunning the dunya, you know, living this life of isolation, monasticism, no. This is not Islam. Ruhbaniyat has no place in Islam. And this is where Imam says, it is the shaitan who has misguided you. Do not you have any, you know, pity and mercy on your wife and your children? So the first point was, by adopting this kind of lifestyle, you are being unjust to yourself. Aduya nafsa. You are enemy of yourself. And number two, Imam says, don't you have pity and, you know, concern for your wife and children? You abandon them, not fulfilling their rights. And number three, you think by, shunning the luxuries and the good things that Allah has given to us in this dunya, you are making a favor on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? No. Who told you that Allah is saying, this is halal, but you are saying, oh, I don't want to use it. You think you are higher than him? If Allah has made it halal for you to have marriage life, to have a wife, to have children, you know, to have halal good food and a good lifestyle, provided the income comes from the halal way, who are you to shun that and say that, no, I would like to live a different lifestyle? You are too insignificant for Allah to do that. It doesn't mean you are a great person here. You are actually very well ahwan. You are very down there. And when, you know, this fellow basically looked at this response of Amir al-Mu'mineen, he knew Ali's lifestyle. And so he then doesn't give up, wants to justify. And he doesn't realize he's talking to Ali. And he says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, هذا أنت وفي خشونة ملبسك وجشوبة معكلك. O Amir al-Mu'mineen, you are advising that to me, that I shouldn't be doing all this, while you yourself wear very coarse, you know, simple clothes, and your meal is also very simple. So you are telling me to not adapt the lifestyle that you have. And this is where we have to realize, before I come to the response of Amir al-Mu'mineen, yes, Ali lived a simple life. But it doesn't mean that he basically shunned the dunya and went into isolation. He would fulfill his duties to the people and to the society and to his family. And most importantly, he did not depend on the handouts of others for his survival. You wouldn't sit there in the masjid, you know, faqir, in the name of Allah has come, I spend all the time in ibadat. No. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, Amir al-Mu'mineen, yes, he had a very simple life, but that simplicity of his life in his clothing and his food was not because of poverty. It was a matter of choice for him. And why? I'll come later on. But before that, one story about his food. Right in the beginning of his khilafat, there is a khutbah where just one sentence from there where he says to the people of Medina that forget the days where there were privileged classes among you as it was done in the second and the third Khalifa time. Everybody is equal as far as distribution of Baytul Mal is concerned. Al-mal malullah wa antum ibadullah. And then he says something. He says, remember, as long as I have debts coming from my own palm trees, Ali is not going to take his own share from Baytul Mal. And therefore, a person who denies himself his right from Baytul Mal, don't expect extra from him for yourself. So remember his words, as long as my debts, you know, come from my palm trees. So Amir al-Mu'minin was not poor. You know, these gardens that he has established in these 20 years, they survived and became source of income for his descendants till the sixth Imam time at least. At least that I have been able to trace, maybe even later on. And so it was not a matter of poverty for Ali. You know, once in Kufa, there was a companion who had come to visit him, and it became time for food. So Ali said, sit down, have a meal with us. So they sat down with the sufra, you know, and it was normal food, not the food of fuqara. But where Ali came and sat down, you know, everybody had normal bread. But then he took out, you know, opened the lock he had put on the, you know, wax seal on the bag and took out dry bread. That was the one he's eating. Now, the guest seems to be somebody close to them. He could be more open and frank. So he turned to Imam Hassan. He says, you know, what is this? You should be taking care of your father in a way. And these are not exact words, but this is how it sounds in the narration. You know, and this is where Imam Hassan says to him, what can we do? He has told us not to put any butter or fat on the bread to make it soft. And to make sure we don't do that, and the women, ladies of the family don't do that, he actually puts a seal with his own, on that wax seal on the bag. And so everybody is having normal food, but Amir al-Mu'minin is having very simple food there. Why were he doing this? And this is where the response he gives to Asim bin Ziyad, where he basically says to him, وَيْحَكْ أَنِّي لَسْتُكَ أَنْتَ. Woe to you. I am not like you. My position is different. My position as Khalifat al-Muslimin, Amir al-Mu'mineen, demands certain things which is not for you. So don't compare yourself to me. I have certain, you know, expectations that Allah has from me, which He doesn't have from others. And then He says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى فَرَضَ عَلَىٰ أَئِمَّةِ الْحَقِّ أَنْ يُقْدِرَ أَنفُسُهُمْ بِزُعْفَةِ النَّاسِ. Certainly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it obligatory upon a'immatul haq, true leaders. In Usul al-Kafi, the slight change says a'immatul adl, the just rulers. But these are same things. Allah has made it obligatory on them to maintain themselves at the level of the weak people or this weak segment of the society. Kayla yata يَتَبَيَّغَ بِالْفَقِيرِ فَقْرَ, so that the poor do not cry over their poverty. They will say, even our imam is eating the same food as we are eating. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, the lifestyle of Amir al-Mu'minin, yes, it was very simple, but there was a reason that there is an expectation from of him which is different from other people. But the main message that we get is that you can have the luxuries of this dunya, you can have the ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The example here is of the big house, the vast house of Ar-Rabi bin Ziyad. But to have that is not a problem as long as you use it not only for the comfort of this dunya, but as a wasila to take it to the akhirah. And that is by basically having guests coming in, you know, doing silatul rahim and helping the relatives, and number three, fulfilling the financial obligation that you have on yourself. If you are able to do that, you know, then this dunyavi amal and dunyavi ni'mat can be maintained even in the akhirah. Salawat. So basically the issue is not about, you know, whether we should shun this dunya. Nor is it that we should be, you know, so much submerged into it and not realizing what are our duties about it. When it comes to silatul rahim, helping others, or fulfilling the wajibat on a financial matters. You know, let me end with one more story from the life of Imam Ja'far as-Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam. There was a person by the name of Sufyan as-Suri, and he was kind of a, you know, early days Sufis. And one day the sixth Imam came, was sitting with his companion, and Sufyan comes in, and he saw that the sixth Imam, the clothing that he had was of a good quality. And he looks at the Imam, and he being a Sufi-minded person, he says, you know, what kind of, you know, clothes you are wearing? This is not what Rasulullah and Ali used to wear. They used to wear really very simple clothes, and you have this good quality clothing. And Amir al-Mu'min, the Imam Ja'far as-Sadiq looked at him and he says, you know, who told you that the blessings of Allah is only for the sinners? Is this what you want? That only sinners should use the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the believers and the good doers are not allowed to use it? So he kind of became, you know, upset, kind of left. But the companions continued the discussion. They told the Imam that the point he has is still, you know, valid. It needs a response. That the lifestyle of Rasulullah and Ali in their clothings were different from yours. And this is where Imam Ja'far as-Sadiq says, you people are confused. Islam is not the lifestyle and the clothing and the style of the clothing. Islam is muwasat. A leader is expected to live a life where even the poor people can relate to him. And that level or lifestyle will change from time to time and place to place. In the days of Rasulullah and Amir al-Mu'mineen, sixth Imam says, that the normal condition of the early Muslims were that, you know, not everybody was, majority were not comfortable. And therefore they had to live that lifestyle. But by our time, mashallah, you know, the Muslim society is very affluent. And therefore, I allowed myself to wear better kind of clothes, maintaining the common standard of our time. And so what Ali did was right for his time. What I did here is right. If Ali had been in my place, he would be wearing these kinds of clothes. If I was during the days of Ali, I would be wearing those kinds of clothes. Salawat Banda Ikbara. And so when it comes to the A'imma in that way, this is what they are saying, that, you know, they have to look at the circumstances. It's not just, you know, one issue for all the time and all the places. And this is where we have to realize the muwasat is the main thing, you know, to maintain that level where a common man can relate to that leader. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to understand the true teachings of Islam, and may He always keep us on the path of Muhammad and Ali Muhammad salawatullah alayhi ajma'in. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasanatan wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhaban nar bi rahmatika ya rahman rahimin.